Am I a candidate hair transplant? I'm a 35-year-old female. I was diagnosed with thyroid disease 3 years ago, postpartum. It took over a year to get my dose leveled and hair loss to become normal. I am now regulated, but the hair has not recovered, even though it has been over a year. I would like to pursue hair transplant, but I'm scared of permanent shock loss occurring in recipient area. What are your thoughts? Am I a candidate? And how likely is it I will look worse after a transplant than when I started?
Thank you for your question. You're 35 years old and you've given a very good history about your issues with hair loss after pregnancy with some thyroid related issues. And you're asking a very simple question about whether or not you're a candidate for a transplant. Well, the photos you submitted are also very good in terms of what a lot of women notice when they have hair loss, and that is the classic widening of the part. As a specialist in hair restoration, I'm going to also bring to your attention some other alternatives to transplantation. But first I'm going to explain to you why I'm very hesitant to transplant female patients. Female pattern hair loss is more diffuse than male pattern hair loss. Male pattern hair loss is a recession of the temples and an expanding of the crown, the bald spot area, and eventually the areas meeting in the middle and progressing. With women, that hair loss pattern tends to be more diffuse. Now, there's also a challenge in diagnosing the type of hair loss when you have stressors such as pregnancy. There's a condition called telogen effluvium, or shock loss. And sometimes the telogen effluvium, even after the stress is over, you may not get back all the hair that you lost. Hormonal issues also play a big role in hair loss for women. Then comes genetics. So in our practice, one of the things that I found particularly frustrating with transplantation in women is because there is diffuse thinning, there's very little space between the hairs. When you look at a male pattern hair loss, an area can be smooth and bald, and then when you place the grafts, you're going into skin that doesn't have existing hair. And even when you do place grafts in between existing hairs, there's often very large gaps so that you're not shocking the existing hair. We routinely use a microscope in our examinations of hair. And I can tell you, when we look at the hair of women with thinning, the space between the hairs is often very limited. So what ends up happening in a lot of scenarios with female pattern hair loss treatment with transplantation is you can place a hair, but you may lose one or two hairs at the same time, and you'll end up going nowhere. We have been very fortunate in the past several years in developing a method of treatment of female pattern hair loss using something called hair regeneration that we created. This is a treatment using platelet-rich plasma combined with a material called extracellular matrix. Now, this extracellular matrix is derived from pig bladder and was originally intended for wound healing. It just so happened that in an effort to use it for improvement of hair transplant procedures, it was noted that hair thinning became improved, or thin hairs became thicker. So what we've been doing is treating male and female pattern hair loss, as well as conditions such as alopecia areata, with the hair regeneration treatment. And essentially, 99% of our female patients, we do the hair regeneration treatment rather than do a transplantation. The exceptions are women who need a frontal hairline. If there is a loss of frontal hairline and there is no hair there, then certainly a transplantation makes a lot of sense. But when there's diffuse thinning, we will first do an evaluation, an examination, a review of hormonal status, a proper medical workup to eliminate all other factors, and then in some cases we may even do a biopsy in order to ensure that there isn't a scarring condition going on concurrently. A lot of times the patients who come to us have already done a lot of that groundwork by going to doctors locally or to major universities to first see what their diagnosis is. It's very important to also understand that although this material has been very successful for us, the full understanding as to why it works is still based on clinical data. That means that we believe that what we're doing through this wound healing mechanism is restoring some of the native stem cell activity that restores the hair growth cycle such that thinning hairs become thicker. In addition, it turns out that the hairs that we are regenerating actually comes back darker. We don't take gray hair, we don't bring back gray hair, I should say, it actually comes back darker. And in so many cases, we've had patients even report that it came back more of a particular way that was present when they were teenagers. So we have been very, very fortunate, and I would ask you to actually learn more about the extracellular matrix and hair regeneration process so you can learn how this may be a very good alternative. At the current time, for most of our patients, we only do one injection, one treatment, and we follow people at 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, and most of our female patients will actually see results starting around 9 months to about a year. There is a synchronization of the hair growth cycles and you just need a critical amount of time for hair to grow long enough so you can see the difference. So I would advise you, based on your question, to not do the transplant at this time, but learn more about this hair regeneration option and then make a decision on how you'd like to proceed. Again, there are unfortunately limited options when it comes to female hair loss. And so the options really have to be properly evaluated before you make a fully informed decision. So I wish you the best of luck. I hope that was helpful. And thank you for your question.